picture on the front of the bulletin may be one of the most commonly known, commonly seen pictures of Christian faith and Western culture. It is of Jesus knocking at the door. I believe this version was done by a fellow named William Hunt, the painter. I'm not certain. It's hard to keep track of all the different versions. But that image comes from the book of Revelation, a book commonly associated with fire and brimstone and fear. Revelation actually being a book about hope. That's a sermon for another day. But here is, at the beginning of the book of Revelation, there are letters to the churches. And this letter to the church at Laodicea is written, and at the end of the letter, it speaks of this image, how Jesus knocks. And are you willing to answer when Jesus knocks? And the artist has added details. I mentioned before the importance of filling in the white spaces. When you read scripture, how do you fill? As I was saying, the reading of scripture, you fill in the white spaces, right? You've got to fill in how we make the movie version of this. And if you look at this, there are details that the artist fills in. For example, Jesus is left-handed. I don't know if that matters. What does matter is, if you look at the door, is there a doorknob on the outside? Jesus can knock on the door, Jesus can thump on the door, Jesus can take a 2x4 and take a whack at the door, which is what it took to get my attention, personally. But Jesus cannot open the door. The doorknob is on the inside. And so when we hear that Jesus is seeking us, as a shepherd seeks lost sheep, we talk about Jesus knocking and already wanting to open the door. It is something that we have to do for ourselves. It's a decision that we make to accept Jesus as the gift that he offers. Now let's take a minute to sort of make the movie version of what happens next. Like, Jesus comes to the door, knocks, and, "Oh, Jesus, I'm so glad to see you, and I would like to offer you forgiveness." "Oh, thank you, Jesus, that's wonderful, I accept, that's a wonderful gift," right? And so what happens next? "Well, I've got some coffee, mate, come on in, have coffee. Okay, having coffee with Jesus, so you'll give me rain." "Yeah, I got about 3 cents. "What are you doing this week, Jesus?" "Well, I thought I'd be a wet hurricane." "Oh, good job, Jesus, thank you." "Okay, well, that's good. Next week, same time, same place." "Good." And then Jesus, like, leaves until he knocks again, right? That's the imagery we get when we think about Jesus knocking, because we think that when Jesus knocks, and then he comes in, and we have welcomed Jesus into our life. If you think about the way we describe what happens here, you hear phrases like, "Accept Jesus into your heart," right? "Jesus as my personal Lord and Savior." You've heard this language before. Right? The imagery is always that Jesus is coming into my house, my place, my gig. It's all about me, right? The thing is, if Jesus knocks at the door, and it's your intention, or when Jesus knocks at the door, and you open the door, Jesus did not be born of flesh and come to us so that we could invite Jesus into our lives. Because what are our lives about? Me, right? Because my life, my dreams, my hopes, my desires, and my plans. Jesus is not knocking on the door so that I can have coffee with Jesus, chill for a bit, and send him on my way so that then I can get back to doing what I think is important, what I care about. You open the door, and you welcome Jesus. But it's not that you're going to welcome Jesus into your life. Jesus is there to welcome you into his. There's a difference there. It might sound like a minor difference, but it means the world, right? If I open the door and invite Jesus into my life, then it's all about me. And Jesus came so that we can be welcomed into his life, his dreams, his goals, his passions, right? I think this is what Jesus is getting at when he's talking to the Pharisees, and he gives them an answer. It's important to keep track of the types of Jews in the New Testament. There are three. There are the Essenes, they're just angry at everyone, and they go out in the desert to get angry. You don't actually see them in the Bible. They're just out there being angry at people. So then they don't appear in this film. And then there are the Sadducees and the Pharisees. And the Sadducees, if you were going to caricature them, they would be the sort of educated liberals who have sold their soul to the man for power. They are the they are the people who control Jerusalem, and they have made a power brokering deal with Rome to give them continued control of the high priesthood of the Sanhedrin. So they have sold their soul for power. And so Jesus never has anything good to say to the Sadducees. He pretty much, Sadducees, they give him flack, and he gets it right back. You're a rooted lifer, right? The Pharisees are different, though. The Pharisees are genuinely attempting to figure out how to follow, how to be faithful, how to live the Bible as they understand it. And so when they ask a question, they might be approaching it wrongly, but Jesus gives them an answer. He says, you need to try, look at it like this. And so when the Pharisees come to him and they say, John's disciples fast, your disciples don't. What's up with that? And he says to them, do you fast when you're at a wedding? No, right? When you're at the wedding, that's not time to fast, that's time to feast. Right? This is not about doing how it used to be done, this is about embracing something new. And so Jesus uses this example. You don't take new wine, freshly crushed grapes, and put it into stretched out leather wineskins, because once leather is stretched out, it's not going to stretch any further. You put the new wine in and it's going to burst. Right? In the same way, if you have an old pair of jeans, it's all stretched out, and you put on a new piece of jean material, patch it, that new jean material is going to stretch out, and the patch isn't going to hold. And so he talks about how if it's new, you got to embrace it in new ways. And so when Jesus comes, Jesus is not coming to condone the way that things used to be done. We're not going to fast like that anymore. That's the old way of doing things. We're not here to be invited by Jesus into our lives. We're being invited into His. This is a new way of doing things. So new wine means new wineskins. And I think this is what we see when Jesus calls the disciples. Jesus does not go up to the disciples and say, oh, I see you're a fisherman. You got an extra rod? Right? Jesus doesn't join them in being a fisher. Jesus says, follow me and join what I'm doing, and I will make you a fisher of men. The disciples are called to be part of what Jesus is doing. He doesn't sit down and become part of what they're doing. We are being wrapped up in the life of Jesus and his dreams and desires and his hopes and his plans. Whatever those dreams and plans, wherever they might take us, wherever they might go. And in following them, we're getting wrapped up in the dreams and desires and passions of Jesus. We will find ourselves in some weird places. Have you ever had a moment where you think, how did I end up here? I have, right? And it's often because I was faithful to Jesus. And wow, I would never have guessed that I would have ended up here. Right? I'm a city boy from Chicago. I follow Jesus, and I'm here because of Jesus. And that's awesome. But if you'd asked me at age 17, where are you going to live for the best years of your life? And what out of them? Well, I think I'm going to be in rural Missouri. But I wouldn't have another place. But that's where Jesus is. Because you get wrapped up into Jesus' dreams and desires, and they are not going to be yours. So how do we do this? How do we do this? If I'm going to get wrapped up into the life of Jesus, if I'm not welcoming him into my life, but accepting the invitation into his, how do we do this? How do we do it well? There is, John Wesley talked about the means of grace. Right? You cannot know where you're going to go on this journey, but the means of grace are the way you prepare. If you know you're going on a hike, you might not know where the hike will take you, but you can make certain you have good boots on. You can be prepared for what's going to happen next. And that's what the means of grace are. They're ways to prepare for where God will lead us. And I'll tell you what the means of grace are, and there's not going to be a single surprise among them. You've heard them before. The means of grace, the way that you prepare to become part of the life of Jesus, are prayer. Public prayer, private prayer. Searching the scriptures, reading them, hearing them, meditating upon them alone and with others. The Lord's Supper, coming to worship together, confession, passing the peace. Public worship, coming together to sing and to pray and to confess our faith. Fasting, which Jesus assumes that we're going to do so that we can focus on what matters, what is essential, and learn to set aside that which is not. Holy conferencing, which Wesley uses as a term to talk about getting together in discussion about how are we going to follow Jesus together? What do we need to hear from each other? Then we go out and we serve folk. we also prepare to be wrapped up in the dreams and desires and passions of Jesus by going out and feeding the hungry and clothing the naked and caring for the sick and being good news to those who need it. And this is John Wesley, when he starts the Methodist Church, he explains to folk that this is the meat of religion, right? When Jesus knocks on the door, and you say, Jesus, thank you, right? That's repentance, and that's a good start. Salvation is when you go with Jesus, but the journey, actually going somewhere, that's the meat of faith, that's the meat of religion. It's the journey with Jesus, going where he is going to go along the way. Now, we know that these are the building blocks of the Christian faith. I'm sure, as I said, no surprises here. Yet, if we are honest with ourselves, we're not always excited about practicing them. There are ways that we struggle with them. And that is not a surprise. It was true in Wesley's day. It is true today. And there are at least two temptations when it comes to the means of grace, the ways that we prepare ourselves to follow Jesus. One way, one temptation, one confusion is that we get the means and the ends confused. We grow to love being quiet just for the stillness of it, not because of how it creates a space we can hear God. We might grow to love serving others because we feel good about it. You serve others and it feels really good, and we miss the fact that we serve others so that we might meet Christ. Because sometimes when you serve others, it doesn't feel good, and that's not the point. You serve it because that's how we meet Christ. All right, and so we get means and ends confused. We might read the Bible to learn, I want to be a better person, raise our children to do the right thing. We read the Bible to meet Jesus. Right? That's why we read the Scripture. All we do as Christians is to set the table for God so that we might better know him. And we need to keep that end, to better know Christ in mind as we do these things. Athletes don't lift weights so that they can lift weights. Athletes lift weights so that they can play the game. Right? We go through the means of grace, not so that we can go through the means of grace, but so that we might better know Jesus. We remember, so that's the first temptation, getting means and ends confused. The second temptation, I think, is a temptation in quietism. How often do we spend time praying to God for guidance? Right? God has shown what to do. We spend a lot of time praying to God for guidance. That is excellent and good and wonderful. And sometimes we need to move beyond that and say, God, I pray for courage to do what I already probably figured out you want me to do. Praying for guidance eventually does need to be praying for courage. And in the quiet, there are times to say, be still and know that I am Lord. There are times to be quiet and to wait. But there are also times when we just got to go and do what Jesus would do. We're here to be wrapped up in Jesus' life and go follow his dreams and passions. And so we go and we do it. Right? We are waiting upon God, but waiting upon God is not sitting still. Waiting upon God is far more like a farmer waiting for the crops to come in. You ever know a farmer to be chilling while the crops are about to come in? There's always something to do. Right? In that same sense, we're waiting while we're doing what needs be done. Jesus may have a word for us today or tomorrow or the day after, but if we're not actively reading Scripture, praying, putting aside time, serving, we might just miss it. These are the basics, right? Prayer, fasting, studying Scripture, service, worship, time with other Christians. These are the activities that the church exists to facilitate. Right? If you are struggling with any of these, the gathering of Christians needs to be the answer for you. If you are struggling with any part of following Jesus, studying Scripture, service, worship, prayer, and so if you are struggling with any of them or confused by them or annoyed by them, come and ask me. Right? It took me years to learn how to pray. And because what happens when I sit down to pray in the morning, bow your heads, close your eyes, bow my head, close my eyes in the morning, you know what I do? What happens when I close my eyes in the morning? I fall back asleep, right? And so for me to pray, I had to figure it out. It took me years. I have to get out a pen and a piece of paper, and I have to write. Right? And there are mornings where I got nothing. I look at the page, and I write, God, dot, dot, dot. And then I have something else. I have figured out that there are people who are wiser and holier and more saintly than I am, and I find their prayers and I write them. This is my book of the prayers of the saints. And so I write the prayers of the book of the saints because that's what it took for me to figure out how to pray. So if you see this book, what that meant is, now you know what that meant. So I looked at a piece of paper and I was stumped. But I looked to a saint and I learned, and it helped me to grow in my faith. So if you are struggling with some aspect of following Jesus about the means of grace, come to me. There are many ways to study, to read, to serve, to pray. I'll help you figure out what you need to do. But the long and short of it is when Jesus knocks, the answer is not to bring him into your life, but to go get wrapped up in his. Amen. Yeah, we need this in a minute. Please stand and join with me as we confess together using the words of the Apostles' Creed.